Hi and welcome to Health and Beauty Base YouTube channel. This video is on the signs and symptoms of kidney cancer, or more specifically, renal cell carcinoma, which is the most common cancer of the kidney. So in this video, we're going to talk about the signs and symptoms of kidney cancer, or renal cell carcinoma, and we'll talk about why those signs and symptoms occur. Before we talk about the signs and symptoms, let's talk about what renal cell carcinoma is and some risk factors for getting it. We mentioned that renal cell carcinoma is going to be the most common cancer of the kidney. Now, there are different types of cancers that affect the kidney, including sarcomas, Wilms tumor, which we can see in children, but this is going to be the most common type. So we're going to focus on renal cell carcinoma in today's video. Now, there are multiple risk factors for getting this type of cancer. One of them is cigarette smoking. This is going to be the most important risk factor for getting this cancer. We also see obesity being a risk factor as well, especially in female patients. Hypertension or high blood pressure is also associated with an increased risk of renal cell carcinoma. Exposure to chemicals is going to be a very, very important risk factor for getting renal cell carcinoma. These include chemicals like trichloroethylene, which we can find in paint thinners and degreasing solutions. We can also see benzene exposure being another potential chemical that can increase the risk. Benzene can be found in cigarette smoking, but can also be found in cleaning supplies. Benzene exposure is also another potential risk factor. So benzene used to be found more commonly in the dyeing process for clothing and cloths. Herbicide exposure is also another risk factor, and vinyl chloride exposure is also another risk factor as well. Long-term non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug use, so using long-term use, especially higher doses of ibuprofen, may increase the risk of kidney cancer as well, or renal cell carcinoma. Multiple episodes of kidney stones, especially in male patients, may also be another risk factor. And genetic conditions like von Hippel-Lindau syndrome is also another risk factor for getting kidney cancer. So the majority of cases of renal cell carcinoma are going to be sporadic, meaning that they're going to occur randomly. This is going to account for 95% of cases, whereas the other 5% of cases will be due to familial causes, so family inheritance reasons or genetic conditions. This cancer is also going to occur most commonly between the ages of 60 to 70 years of age, and males are more affected than females, and males outnumber females 2-to-1 with this cancer. Now let's talk about the signs and symptoms of renal cell carcinoma. So it's important to note that many cases are asymptomatic, meaning that they are not going to show any signs or symptoms at all. Roughly 25 to 30% of patients with renal cell carcinoma are going to be asymptomatic. And especially early on in the disease progression, and later on in the disease progression, we're going to see more and more symptoms occurring. So again, 25 to 30% are going to be asymptomatic. But if they do have symptoms, some of the symptoms include hematuria. So hematuria is going to be blood in the urine. The blood in the urine may be microscopic or macroscopic, meaning that if it's microscopic, the patient's not going to see it. But if we use a urine dipstick, we can see it on a urine dipstick or urinalysis. If it's macroscopic, the patient can see it. So they can actually see the color of the urine is going to be red in coloration, and that's going to be macroscopic or gross hematuria. And we can see hematuria occurring in other conditions as well, including kidney stones and urinary tract infections. But if an older patient is having hematuria, it's always, always important to investigate the cause, especially investigate for renal cell carcinoma as a potential cause. So it's important to look out for some of the major causes of hematuria, especially in older age patients. And with regards to which one's more common, microscopic or macroscopic, microscopic is going to be more common. So the patient's not going to often see the blood in their urine. But if they have some urinalysis for other reasons, or some urine dipstick and there's blood found, then that's going to be important to investigate that further, especially in older age patients. And hematuria is going to occur in 40 to 60% of patients. So this is going to be a very common and important finding to look out for. Another symptom of renal cell carcinoma is going to be flank pain. So it's going to be pain on the flanks or on the sides. So the pain can be intermittent or it can be constant in some cases, and it can worsen over time as the disease progresses. And this will occur in roughly 40% of patients. We can also see a palpable mass in some patients, so a mass that may be palpable or felt in the abdomen or on the flank. Patients can describe having a feeling of fullness or pressure on their flank as well. That may also be something that patients note, and this will occur in 25% of cases. Now, those are going to be the main hallmark characteristic findings of renal cell carcinoma, and they are actually considered the classic triad of this particular cancer. So the classic triad again is flank pain, flank mass, and hematuria. And unfortunately, the classic triad is going to be only found in 10% of patients. So I mentioned that flank pain can occur in 40% of patients. Flank mass can occur in 25% of patients. Hematuria can occur in 40 to 60% of patients, but all of these together are only going to occur in roughly 10% of patients. And if patients have all three of these, that's indicative of advanced disease. Now, some other important signs and symptoms of renal cell carcinoma include constitutional symptoms like weight loss. So weight loss is going to be unintentional. The patient's not trying to lose weight. They're not on a diet. They're not trying to lose weight. They're just simply losing weight. And this often occurs over months of time. And this is going to occur in at least one-third of patients with renal cell carcinoma. And the weight loss is going to be due to the fact that the cancer is stealing nutrients from the patient. So the cancer's utilizing nutrients to grow itself, and the patient's not being able to use those nutrients. And that's leading to weight loss in the patient. Patients can also have fever and night sweats. So fever can be a temperature greater than 30 degrees Celsius. And if patients have night sweats, that means that they will sleep through the night and they will profusely sweat during the night. Often, it's described as drenching their bed sheets. These are going to be less common than the weight loss in renal cell carcinoma, but they can occur as well. And then fatigue can also be an important finding in renal cell carcinoma. So having low energy, feeling very tired, and patients can also have a feeling of malaise as well, just feeling generally unwell. We can also see anemia occurring in patients with renal cell carcinoma. So anemia is going to be low hemoglobin levels or low levels of red blood cells. This is going to be due to reduced production and release of erythropoietin from kidneys. So that kidney mass that's growing can prevent normal functioning kidney tissue from producing erythropoietin. And erythropoietin is going to be an important hormone that the kidneys produce that ends up helping in the production of red blood cells. So erythropoietin is going to be released from the kidneys normally, and then it's going to act on bone marrow to produce red blood cells. So in the case of renal cell carcinoma, the cancer is going to grow. It's going to damage surrounding functional kidney tissue, and that's going to prevent the production release of erythropoietin. So it'll lead to lower levels of erythropoietin. And this is going to lead to anemia. And the signs and symptoms of anemia, including fatigue, pallor, conjunctival pallor, presyncope, and syncope, so feeling lightheaded or dizzy and potentially fainting. These will all be potential findings in anemia that's caused by renal cell carcinoma. And we can also see hypertension in renal cell carcinoma as well. So hypertension is going to be high blood pressure, so it's often going to be greater than 140 over 90. This is going to occur in 20% of patients. This is going to be an important and not uncommon finding we can see in these patients. Now, renal cell carcinoma is going to be considered a cancer in disguise. Oftentimes, this particular cancer is going to have many different paraneoplastic syndromes, so it can mimic many different types of conditions. These include erythrocytosis. So erythrocytosis is going to be high levels of red blood cells. So in contrast to the anemia we talked about before, we can see in some cases erythrocytosis, or high levels of red blood cells, or what we'd call secondary polycythemia. This is, again, going to be more rare than anemia, but it can occur. And this is going to be due to cancer cells producing high levels of erythropoietin. So instead of the cancer damaging tissues that produce erythropoietin, the cancer itself may start to produce erythropoietin. So it can produce very high levels of erythropoietin, leading to high levels of red blood cell production and high levels of red blood cells. This can lead to multiple different findings, including pruritus or itching sensation, especially after having a hot shower or hot bath. We can also see erythromyalgia. We can also see headaches. These are all going to be symptoms of erythrocytosis. And we can also see hypercalcemia occurring in renal cell carcinoma as well. So hypercalcemia is going to be high levels of calcium in the blood. This is due to cancer cells producing parathyroid hormone-related peptide, or PTHRP. So PTHRP is going to mimic normal parathyroid hormone that's produced by the parathyroid glands, which are four glands located behind your thyroid. These glands normally produce parathyroid hormone in response to low calcium levels to ultimately lead to an increased level of calcium. So if the cancer is producing high levels of parathyroid hormone-related peptide, it can lead to high levels of calcium by increasing the absorption of calcium from the gastrointestinal system and increasing the reabsorption of calcium from the functional kidney. And this can all lead to hypercalcemia and signs and symptoms of hypercalcemia. These include muscle weakness, fasciculations, changes in bowel habits, and altered mental status. Now, this particular cancer can also metastasize to other parts of the body. So around one-third of cases of renal cell carcinoma will have been found to have metastases. So some of the metastases can include metastases to the lungs. This occurs in 75% of patients with metastases. Bones can also be affected. So 20% of patients with metastases will have metastases to bone, and roughly 18% of patients will have metastases to the liver if they have metastatic disease. So metastases to lungs can lead to dyspnea or shortness of breath. Metastases to bones can lead to bone pain, especially in the lower back. And metastases to the liver, if it is significant, if there's enough liver tissue that's been damaged, there can be hepatic failure. And that can lead to a host of different signs and symptoms from liver disease, like jaundice and ascites and many, many others. If you haven't already, please like and subscribe for more videos like this one. And as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.